theater.
Just saying.
Possible.
There's
something that was really formative for me. I'm from West Virginia, and after the Manhattan Mine disaster in the late 60s, there was a protest.
Picking it apart.
Demonstration slash memorial for the many miners who were killed.
Hi, come on in. So, we just started.
It wasn't about us at all, but in some ways we saw our journeys together, you know?
Together in small groups about an important aesthetic experience that you had, like a physical art or something that defines your sense of curation.
That can be a really tedious practice.
So we'll just divide
ourselves.
Like art,
would
we do something?
Oh yeah, do that. So come here.
We were doing it, but we couldn't
see.
All right, why don't both of you go with that one over there? Because he's by himself.
I love it.
Welcome.
One of my most recent, actually, memories was being back in Hawaii.
And being amongst the
holocaust, which are like the beautiful dresses
today, and now as an adult, I'm friends with him, but he's my hero.
Whatever, it's just flowers and shit.
The whole crowd was so angry and so sad.
The design and the inclusion of nature,
through this music. Everybody was singing along and screaming along with these songs.
I'm going to rock it like the way people rock it. African.
So cool. And just to understand what it means as a ritual. And the craftsmanship and
being a kid and being whatever. I want to wear Doc Martens. Not being, just coming back.
I think what it was he had artistry that he brought to a specific moment.
Culture.
He said, I see how this applies. He made it apply.
We just got back, actually. We were there. Yeah, he met my dad. So Lucy, I met my dad.
That's beautiful.
And he met all the aunties.
There are a few people that have definitely
So I
speak about education in terms of my
father really couldn't stop it, but they could. So he met all of them, and he cooked for them.
It was the first time I thought smart.
Very smart.
I love that. I ate a bowl of tea.
Such a sweetie. So David, do you have an aesthetic moment that you would like to share with the people sitting next to you?
Very attractive Asian man.
Right.
I never knew that I could be attracted to. So it was just one of those things.
Besides those pictures of your little granddaughter, that's a wrap.
In Newton.
In Montreal, recently we saw the new
Wasn't critical mass that you felt like there were Asian guys working.
And we had
I did have a crush on once. I did go to Chinese school.
But
it was not normal. I thought he was sort of like the exception. I just sort of was like the one I had a crush on. But it was like an actual actor, speaking English, not Bruce Lee,
he was sitting by himself, because I was part of another group.
And they were living in New York's Chinatown, speaking English without an accent, but also living very much a bicultural experience, which I felt like I lived in Newton, but
and then when it started,
we were in Chinatown all the time. It started this little fire in me, which I can only look back on now that I'm older, realizing it was that moment that I had always been searching for moments like that. As I got into my 20s,
the end of the show, I got up and I sort of made my way over to him at the end of his aisle to say,
And I said, I'm sorry that I didn't see it. Polly. That I didn't say Toronto when you couldn't see it in English.
Yeah, I shared one. Yeah, I was talking about. I actually said it when I saw you last week. It was Lynette and me watching a show I worked on, a transgender musical I worked on in New York. And I've been working on it for 6 weeks as an artist.
And that's art, though. That's art.
And then we saw the opening together. My spouse in New York, and we saw it together at the opening.
And just sat and wept through the whole thing.
But I just, I couldn't speak, and I didn't want to speak. I didn't want anybody to get into my brain.
A journey that we've been through together in a way.
Come on up closer.
Pieces of that journey, and then just being able to, like, just, like, sit in the word and let the art, like, tell the emotional journey in a way that we can't do just the two of you talking it out, you know? Yeah.
It's like you're too in it.
You're too in it, you know, so you can't. So you need art as that kind of.
Okay. Oh.
So it was like that.
on HowlRound TV. So thank you for HowlRound being here. HowlRound is a digital organization of ArtsEmerson. It's part of the Office of the Arts.
Yay!
Check out HowlRound.com. They're doing awesome work.
Absolutely.
All of our have been live streamed and have live beyond the conversation itself. Great. So, thanks, HowlRound.
Thanks, HowlRound.
HowlRound is HowlRound.
Wait here, I'll text it to say it gets me out at night. So it goes up there.
It's the sound of a freaking feedback that happens when you hold a microphone up to the speaker.
So it's literally the field feeding back on itself, because it's all practitioners and audience talking about the work.
So we are going to have Harry and Sam, our wonderful students, bring microphones to you so that the people watching at home can hear you. As we hear your responses to many experiences that you've had out and about. And when you get the microphone,
can everybody hear me?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
that's good.
Too loud. Is that better?
That's better.
Okay, hi, my name is Lucien. So moment for me that really changed was not long ago, actually. 2 or 3 weeks ago, I went to Hawaii. And I really changed what I want my final destination to be. One of the small memory that I have about that vacation was I was sitting on the beach next to a beautiful mermaid, and then the two guys walk on the beach, and there was a tiny piece of paper on the sand, and those guys actually took the time. Those guys actually took the time to pick up that little piece of paper that was on that beach and put it in his pocket. And it's like there's such a respect of Mother Nature. It's so beautiful. The culture of people, just like good food, inviting. We went to see a guy that was like as big as a house, but he was gentle as a little puppy. And it's just like it changed my vision of when I came back. When I left, I had a plan. When I came back, that's it. That was. I'm going there. So that was my moment.
I love words, I love plays, I love stories, but in fact, possibly my most memorable aesthetic experience was around the holidays when I was in New York City and stopped in at a performance of Antigone reinterpreted by Soledad Barrios in flamenco dance. Mm-hmm. And seeing a play that I am familiar with, reinfused with a new energy, with a woman no longer in the peak of young youth that we usually think of as beautiful, and this woman that was a little bit older, her passion, her zest, and her drama written on her body was so transporting. I felt I am in the hands of a master, and I am watching, I am honored to watch this transformative moment. And it was in this not fancy, you know, hall. It was in a theater, and it felt all of the better in the sense that it felt like a discovery.
Mm-hmm.
My name is Harvey Leong, and I'd like to say that my life in China, which is a movie that Kenneth Eng made, a documentary about his dad and his journey from China to Boston, and how he raised his sons, and how he dedicated his whole life to his children. And it was quite moving. And his trip back to China, and then the irony that of the movie was that he said, well, maybe I should have stayed, because Cousin Joe is doing so well, Cousin Lou, and so it's quite memorable, very good.
My name's Melissa Nussbaum Freeman. And what was very striking in our conversation was the importance of silence and listening. And that was, there were several examples. For me, the strongest, most important example came during an intensive at Shakespeare and Company. Anybody gonna go? I don't want to ruin it for you.
spoiler alert!
Spoiler alert!
Your
close your ears if you're going to the intensive. It's called Elizabethan Worldview Day, and all the students are gifted with a day where all the teachers and the TAs create an incredibly precious space, where hundreds of books about the world and theater and art are laid out, and you walk into the space and the teachers are, they're all reading, and there's just this beautiful music. And before you enter the space, someone touches your heart and welcomes you home. It's quite stunning. And then we all shared our sonnets.
Hello, my name is Igor Golyak, and I came in late, and we were just exchanging our inspirations with David here, and we actually, one of the things that we exchanged was the ArtsEmerson presentation of Lev Doden's Three Sisters. And it moved, and was also just so strange. It was kind of surreal for me, because seeing Lev Doden here and seeing him in St. Petersburg, it's quite a, you know, when you replant a plant, for an exotic plant from its origin, and replant it in Boston. and it starts blooming here too. So that's the bloom that we agreed on, and thank you.
Beautiful.
That's a great note to end on.
Yeah, so what we'd like to do, hear a little bit from you all, and then I'm going to hand it over to Abe. It's just, what, as curators, and we'll get to, Abe will introduce you guys and what you do specifically, but as curators, what are you hearing in those responses, right? Like, what curation went into bringing these people these moments that that were so memorable?
I heard a theme. I heard a little bit of a theme of home, and that a sense of people want to feel like they are connected to something. I mean, home is like the deepest connection, whatever that means for people.
Yeah.
And so that people picked experiences that whatever home meant for them, and it was different things that I heard, but whatever home meant for them, they gravitated towards aesthetic experiences that touched that sensibility.
That reminds me of a piece, actually, called Where You'll Find the David Kale. It's actually all about different characters' experiences of where you'll find them, and then you'll find them where they think of their home.
Yeah.
I mean, so as a curator, I would look at that piece this audience or something. Wow, we should do that. But also interesting, this notion of mastery to me, I heard that. The difference between mastery and what's sexy, and what's where the popular culture might define something as important, as different from where an aesthetic, an important aesthetic is really. And that's actually a big part of the job, is to cut through the noise of what's perceived to be popular, what's acknowledged to be popular, and get to what's necessary for a community. Sometimes it's gonna come from that. And then the other thing is this blooming, very important to us here at ArtsEmerson, that we're actually attempting to make a conversation between, basically, I mean, it would be like these are exotic plants, right? In a way, these things are coming from all these different compounds, and we're saying this is your natural habitat. And how do we make it actually the natural habitat of all of these things? So that's a clearly curatorial direction.
Others?
I think I heard sort of this idea of a journey that, you know, by having this experience, you're taken through an experience and a journey through something, whether the artist, the creator kind of has a vision that they're actually able to share with you through their work and that it touches each of you as an audience member in some way.
Malia?
Oh, I was trying to, that sounds great.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I think I ditto everyone. And one of the things that I heard, too, was this idea of acceptance. With your example, even the Shakespearean example, this example of, someone being replanted as someone who's born and raised in Hawaii and calls Boston home, I feel like I bloom in Boston in a way that I could never bloom in Hawaii. And I could never bloom in Boston if I didn't have Hawaii, and maybe also being mixed race, I go towards that. But I heard a lot of this like joyous harmony of how we can evolve together and how we can become, how we find our way through, and how we find our voice, and whether it's traditional, theater, and you decide that you hear flamenco with it. I mean, that was absolutely beautiful. And I think that's one of the great things that I love about the arts, right, is that we decide what we can do.
That's so beautiful. I think this was kind of said already, but I'll just, I don't know if anyone used the word where, but everyone in one part or another of what they talked about where, and it seems like it sometimes matters more than we give it credit for. Hi, my name's Abe Rybeck, and I'm the moderator today, and I'm the Executive Artistic Director at the Theater Offensive out in your neighborhood. We're a queer theater company that works in four neighborhoods of Boston, and I am very honored to have been asked to moderate a discussion between y'all, okay? So I hope we've started a habit that we'll keep up with, which is hearing from you as much as talking at you today. I think that we've addressed some of this beginning exercise, but I think that what you probably saw is that each of these people up here, this is what they do for a living, is they think about what am I hearing that matters. And I love living in a city with them, so it's a privilege to be up here. I'm gonna read bios, if that's okay. I also want us to continue, as you all speak up, please introduce yourselves too. I already feel like I'm getting to know people today, which I really appreciate.
I didn't go with short bio, because I mean, you can get into it.
Yeah,
I'm trying
that's
to moderate.
True.
I would go short though, because.
So not what's written here.
Yeah, because it's so long. I see
at
how long
least
it is.
A couple of lines. No.
Yeah.
That's an inside joke.
Yeah. I'll just cut to all the magnificent awards. No. I'll just read the first sentence
and that'll be good.
Great.
So Susan Shinson, while serving on the board of the Asian American Resource Workshop.
Yeah.
Yes, love that.
established the annual Boston Asian American Film Festival.
Woo!
Yes, in 2008. So it was a platform to elevate community stories and issues, and has since hosted, Susan has hosted special guests, including George Takei. I was there, that was amazing. And An Lee. So there's a queer thing going on.
Just like, all right, go.
Okay, anyway, that's the end of the first sentence. So I'll stop there. Malia's next on the paper, and that's what matters, right? So upon completing a two-year fellowship at MIT, Malia Lazu returned to Boston, what, across the river?
Across the river.
to build nonprofit models for the 21st century. And I'm gonna read another sentence. With over two decades of experience establishing grassroots involvement in political advocacy and civic engagement, Malia felt the nonprofit industry was too dependent on money, goddammit, and was in need of disruption. Thank you, Malia.
Oh,
I'll
get you out of the house.
Disruption.
Okay, David Dower is the, oh, I didn't say, by the way, that Malia is the executive director of the Epicenter Community, which is a new name for David Dower is the co-artistic director of ArtsEmerson. David, before joining ArtsEmerson in the spring of 2012, David spent six seasons as associate artistic director at Arena Stage, where he directed the artistic development team and founded the American Voices Youth Play Institute, which is the precursor to HowlRound, a center for theater comedy. This is a long sentence.
Tell me there's a period coming.
There's a sentence like on the next page or something.
No.
Just leave it there.
Stop.
Go forward.
Just a sentence.
I'll talk
he
to
you. Wrote
the
that bio. Okay, Polly. Polly Carl is the co-artistic director of Arts Emerson, where he programs an annual season of international work for the downtown theaters of Emerson College. I am going to skip down to also say HowlRound that we mentioned earlier. Polly Carl is also the director and co-founder of HowlRound. So what a group. Now you know why I was feeling so lucky here.
And Abe, what's your bio? What's the first sentence of your bio?
Abe Rybeck is a trashy Jewish communist, safe sex porno,
fabulous. I want that first line.
I'll just go with that for now. You asked. Okay. That's all you need to know, I suppose. So historically, curation is thought of as like some kind of expert where you know, and you're trying to impart on a community, like, oh, I want you all to know the fabulous things that I've worked enough to know and that I've worked so hard to know. How is what y'all do like that or different than that? And I just said it with an attitude, right? Because I wanted to make fun of it a little. But it's also okay to be like that sometimes, you know. So how are you like that or not like that? Like what you do.
You have trouble with a panel of listeners.
I'll take a lead in it and say that I think that we at Epicenter Community, we're really intentional about the in-person experiences that we provide. We want them to be safe spaces. We want them to be a place where people's culture and cultural experience is presented with love and respect. And we want it to be a place where when people walk out, they have a certain amount of, I don't know if I can even say deference ownership, but you know, where it's like you feel like you're a part of this, but you also understand and are grateful towards the people who created this place to make you be a part of. And so our intentionality goes a lot around us saying, to your point, Abe, hey, we know some really great things that like we want you guys to know. And then also also saying, and what do we need to do so that you feel safe walking in to this place? Mm-hmm. So one of the curations that I want to talk about that I think we're the most proud of that we've been doing over the last few years is we've been doing a Juneteenth celebration at the Museum of Fine Arts. So here you have the blackest holiday being celebrated at the whitest institution in Boston. But what you see with that is that the black people are like, oh shit, I didn't know they knew about Juneteenth. You know what I mean? So like all of a sudden they know like this is for us, right? They're not saying like, oh, this is a Martin Luther King Day thing, right? Like it's Juneteenth, it's something that we do that y'all don't know about. And then it's at the MFA, so then the white people are like, oh, well, it's Juneteenth, but it's at the MFA, so we won't get shot.
What is Juneteenth?
Thank you so much for asking, sir.
It doesn't happen in February. Yes.
It does not happen in February, and Juneteenth is actually a fabulous lie that we celebrate.
Right.
So Juneteenth is supposedly the day that a northern soldier found a group of slaves in Galveston, Texas, who didn't know they were free. And so he went to this plantation and he said, ignorant slaves, you're free. But as we talked about at our first Juneteenth celebration, the slaves were a part of their own freedom. So they knew when the war was over, they knew they were free, but it's one of the stories that America likes to tell so that we make sure our history sounds right. So thank you so much for asking. And what Juneteenth has really become is a time for, you know, black folks and folks who know about it to get together, barbecue. In Boston, it was a kite festival. That was a huge example of Juneteenth. And so what we do now is we bring, this year it's gonna be all around fashion design. But we bring together six African-American artists from Boston who get highlighted at the Museum of Fine Arts. And it's just a beautiful place where white people feel comfortable because they don't feel like, oh, I'm going to walk in and say something wrong. You know, like, they feel comfortable. This is like, this is our space, right? We're comfortable here. But also the black community also feels comfortable because they know, well, we know about Juneteenth, right? So we can bring a true value add there. And we bring, we bring about 2,500 people a year there. So I think that's an example of, to me, some of the best curation that we could do with what we have.
Before we go on here, which we're eager to do also, I'd love to hear, has anyone ever been to this Juneteenth celebration or to any of the other things that Epicenter Community or Future Boston have done? Let's just raise our hands first, those of us who've been lucky enough to take part. Does anyone want to say anything about how what Malia just said resonates for you?
Well, just how do we find out more?
Thank you so much for asking. I happen to have. No. So you can follow us at epicenter.com. So epicenter, C-O-M. Epicenter.com.org. You can find us on the web. And I definitely have cards that I can give you. Most of our work that we do is done through social media. We don't do any general advertising. It's all through pre-existing networks, which I think is another thing around our curation, where mm-hmm. the word intentionality is going to come up a lot, I think, for all of us because of how we want to do this work. So,
does anyone else want to talk about their experience of Epicenter, Future Boston? You mentioned this safety thing, which was, you were saying, if I understood correctly, that you've learned a lot about how to create safe space, and that is something that you're trying to share with other people. There is some expertise involved, and you're trying to be transparent about that. There's what we've learned, what can you teach for that? Super. Other things, ways in which this idea of expertise that you're sharing is, that resonates and does not resonate in your approach?
I was just going to speak about the film festival. I myself am not like trained in film criticism or any of that sort of fancy type of stuff, which I consider. I came to this work because of my interest in accessibility of what film journalism, the medium, and the folks that a lot, you know, where it's a volunteer-based organization, and the folks who are the actual programmers are all volunteers. And we have taken the role of being curators very seriously in the sense that we are trying to reflect the community and be mindful of sort of the themes that are currently happening in the community. We understand it's an opportunity to really build build network and to build the Asian American community here in Boston. It certainly served to serve a purpose of, you know, I personally had been trying to find Asian American films that reflected my experience or reflected my understanding of Asian American studies or to advance my understanding of those experiences within my community. Asian American is a very politically constructed term. So for those of us who choose to participate in wanting to know more and be a part of that, the Film Festival, you know, serves that purpose for allowing others, even outside of the community, to still participate and to understand and to gain some of that. So, you know, we make a very conscious effort sort of combining, you know, what's the kind of good for you films and also the entertaining fun stuff.
That is so cool. Does anybody want to talk about their experience at the Asian American Film Festival, Boston Asian American Film Festival, in relation to that kind of point of view?
And if you don't know, the festival takes place here basically the last weekend of October. Towards the end of October, up in the Bright Family Screening Room every year.
It'll be October 20th through the 22nd.
Yeah. I want to just ask one follow-up. The word reflect, and I think it's really, it for some reason jumped out at me, and I'm just curious, what do you observe that makes you think, like, that's reflecting or that's not reflecting?
Well, actually, this gentleman here, Harvey, mentioned the film My Life in China,
yeah.
And that is actually a great example because Tanang, the filmmaker, grew up here in Boston, now currently lives in Los Angeles, but is telling the story about his father. But it's very much a universal, you know, immigrant experience in the sense that many of us come to this country and are trying to do whatever we can by whatever means we have to make it there for the next generation. And we felt that resonated, but the way in which he told it was very much a Chinese American and Asian American experience too, and it sort of had so many different layers upon that,
yeah.
That we really wanted to honor in the fact that it has Boston connections. I think there's also, you know, missed opportunities when you don't have a central place like the film festival to go to. Actually, that was one of the things, Ken, for those of you who might be interested in seeing My Life in China, they'll be screening it in Malden next Thursday, the 14th. Now that I mentioned that. But Ken mentioned to me, we were in conversation, and he had said it was really the Boston Asian American Film Festival that made sort of the biggest difference for him, even though it was towards the end of his festival run. Because we're also located here at WGBH, he also got on the radar of WGBH and has now a contract to have a public broadcast in May through America Refrains, which is on the World Channel. So he felt like he was sort of led to all these other opportunities by participating in something like that. But we felt like it was something that was important to get out there, and he was having a tough time, I think, in other festivals not getting picked up, so it was sort of a challenge for him.
This question of curation, I feel like is a thing I've been thinking about pretty much my whole life in some way or another, but it really, the rubber hit the road for me when I was, I ran a playwriting center, they called the Playwright Center, for a long time in Minneapolis, and the thing that, one of the things about when you work in a center for playwriting is you come across a lot of different kinds of work, right?
Yeah.
So, and there was just an incredible number of voices, stories, aesthetics, kinds of writing, you know, straight plays, experimental plays, it was such a mix of things. And I went to that job having kind of cultivated a very particular sense of my own taste. And that job, in a way, exploded my sense of what curation could be, because it exploded my sense of taste, because I started to get to know artists and got to know so many artists. And of course, there's something about sitting
sitting far away from something and deciding you like it or don't like it, but there's something sitting up close to it that makes you go, oh, this is, you know, and then you know the writer, and then you understand what the writer's trying to tell, the story the writer's trying to tell. And then that job, I loved that job, and it also made me really, really angry because I was working with all these great writers, really interesting stories, and they weren't getting produced. And I would send them to the artistic directors around the country, and you know, the field's maybe an ounce more diverse now, but not that much more. So sending it to a predominantly, similar group of like-minded people who were all doing and producing the same kind of work, and I would send a play and say, oh, we developed this play, audiences love it, it's so beautiful, it does this, this, and this, and they would send me back, oh yeah, you know, I already did an Iraq war play, or I already did, you know, or whatever.
I already did a woman writer.
Yes, I already did a woman writer. Oh yes, I've heard that line. And and I got really, really frustrated by the way that the same kind of 5 or 10 plays were being done by all the same theaters, and that just got me. It just really shook me about that something about curation that on the one hand I love art and I love theater and there are things that I really love and there are things that I really want you to love. And so definitely when I'm curating, I am curating out of love, like there's no question. But I also got really irritated with the artistic director who said, I just curate what I love. Because I felt like that was a really narrow way to think about a community. Because guess what? What I love, you might not love. And so I really started to think about this, I call it the politics of listening. Like what does it mean to curate in a conversation where you're really listening and thinking about the things that you don't love? And what other people need and want and feel at home in. So now I feel like curation, for me, as I get older, it gets ever more complicated. Like it's harder and harder because I know what I love, but I also don't know what I don't know. And so it feels like a constant kind of back and forth between what I love and what I know I don't know. Mm-hmm. And so.
I want to follow up just a little bit with that, unless anybody else is going to. I was just struck right at the beginning of what you said, and then all the way through, you came across such a variety of work, and the bizarre thing that always strikes me from curators is they're saying, like, well, the work's not there, which we all know. I mean, I can't tell if they're simply lying or they have blinders on or what. What's your hit on that from the position that you were in? Because you were saying, like, you just went into this position, there it all, you know, see all this stuff. Yeah. Are people, what's their agenda that's making them not see that?
Well, I mean, I just think, like, it happens, I get it. Like, I mean, one is things aren't there if you're not looking for them, that's for sure, right? So what are you looking for, you know? And then also, I think it's really easy as a curator to get comfortable with the artists you know, the things that are already in front of you, because there's always enough, right? I mean, there's way more plays than you could ever do, no matter how open you are as a curator or how much you're listening. And so I feel like there's always enough. And so it's really, I don't know. Like, I think it's also this thing that what I found, one of the things I found in my time, what really struck me at the Playwright Center was, people would always say to me, well, I know my audience, and my audience won't like that. And I would be like, wow, you already know what your audience is going to like before they arrive at the theater. How boring are all of us then, right? Do you know what I mean? Like, you actually know the things you're going to like before you actually go to the theater, and that just really, like, depressed me. So I feel like that is the kind of thing that I keep, I think people get in a zone of what they think they like and their audience likes, and then that's the zone.
You know, so much of this to me is about, you can use the word intentionality to begin with, and I think that claiming the role of curator is a kind of arrogance. It takes a kind of confidence, and it takes a kind of, blinders in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's about what you're doing with it. And so when you ask about are people lying when they say the work's not there, I think it's simply, in my experience, it has more to do with the fact that they don't have an intention other than sustainability. Whether it's sustainability of the organization or their own position or the culture that they think is most important. And so as a, when you start from a curation of listening, you're actually listening to what's needed. What's your community? Where are you? And what can you bring to it? And what does it need? And as a curator, then my, I mean, I listen to what it is that's happening. I have an intention, I have a point of view. And then I find the work toward that point of view. And when you're not, when the point of view is not explicit, you wind up in these kinds of places that are, well, my audience don't like that, or quality. We can talk about excellence. We can really talk about excellence. We can talk about quality and how those things are actually euphemisms for what's normal, what's comfortable, what's given as a sustainable path. As a curator, I think having had the arrogance to say I'm going to curate, and having put out loud that what I'm curating toward is the transformation, then I have to go after that. And the work, obviously it has to be excellent, obviously it has to speak to an audience, but it has to answer other questions. And it's probably said there's no end of work. I mean, I'm sure you struggle, Susan, to get to the end of what you're selecting.
Yeah.
There's just way more than we could ever possibly do. And there's way, way more than we could possibly do. And so it comes down to, then what do you do? Jackie Lindsay, who many of you in this room know, she challenged us early on here at ArtsEmerson with, well, there are two questions that you need to ask yourself. Is it to be done, first of all? Is it to be done? And then, is it yours to do?
Mm-hmm.
And that second question about is it yours to do forced us to really be clear about what's ours to do. And actually, what's ours to do in the case of the Asian American Film Festival is make the space available. Susan curated. What's
right.
ours to do with Malia is make the space available. Malia, what do you see needs to be done? That's not ours to do to decide what these communities need and how they need it. And that kind of arrogance and curation, I'm comfortable with. That I am taking responsibility for I'm listening, I have a set of assets, I have an idea about the world, and how do I curate access to those assets in order to do that. What happens to our colleagues, I think, so often is that they start here.
Mm-hmm.
And they think, well, I didn't like that play, I didn't like that play, I liked this play. This play is going to cement my, it's going to affirm me, it's going to sustain my organization, it's going to cement my hold on the institution. That, and so without a bigger thing to be doing.
So you mentioned the kind of the bugaboo of quality or excellence. I mean, I've heard people have struggled with this so much, how to talk about how not to use code words.
Yeah.
And I mean, I hear people talk about rigor, for instance, which I think at least is a little more literal. You know what happens. The rigor looks like somebody worked really hard. So what are your thoughts and all of your thoughts on this question of the curatorial eye towards excellence and quality or rigor?
I'll jump on that.
Yeah.
Because I actually think, I believe in my heart and soul, and I've done it my whole career, excellence comes in many dimensions. And the thing I'm always looking for as a curator is for the artist to tell me, for the audience even to tell me, the community to tell me, what dimension are we imagining this on? And the best story I have about excellence, quick story, some of you may have heard me tell it. We did a piece, how many of you saw Not By Bread Alone? The deaf-blind company from Tel Aviv.
Mm.
All right, so this is a deaf-blind company from Israel, and they're telling their story as a kind of a vaudeville, and during the course of the show, they're baking bread, and there are ovens on stage, they bake the bread, at the end of the night, and it's in Hebrew and it's signed, and at the end of the night, the audience is served the same bread. And before you're served the bread, there's this moment where the cast says, sing along if you know this song. And I'm sitting in the audience, I'm thinking, how the hell am I going to know this song? It's from Tel Aviv and it's deaf-blind people. What song could I possibly know that they know? And I'm sitting there on my hands, and the song starts, and the signers are going, and the lyrics in Hebrew are across the stage, but the signers are going, and all the people in the audience who signed along. They sang along. And I suddenly realized, I'm not the point of this moment. This is like, look at, I'm in an audience of people I had no idea were the people. I thought I was the person. I But I heard the whole room full of people who sang along. And so afterwards, I talked to people a lot about excellence with this, because I get it, we get challenged a lot on excellence by a specific set of the audience. And there's a lot of challenges about excellence. And I say, okay, so did you see Not My Bread Alone? Yes. What did you think? Oh, excellent. Okay, you've seen way better acting. You've seen way better dancing. You've heard way better jokes. You even ate better bread. But the dimension on which they were working, they nailed it. And it wasn't on any of those dimensions. And if you sat there going, well, I've seen better acting, it wasn't, you didn't enter. And so excellence to me lives on dimensions, and I need to know from the artist what dimension they're working on, and I need to set that context for the community that I'm working with, and then we can enter it together, and right. We can have the experience.
Thank you.
Is this something David said that made me think?
Yeah. Something David said, that when you curate, clearly you're not only curating the work, you're also curating the audiences that you're trying to reach. Because you're just listening to some of the examples that are being given from the stage. You're talking about, you know, reaching an Asian American audience. You're talking about, you know, reaching an African American audience. You're talking about, in some cases, reaching, you know, lesbian, gay, transgender, you know, that audience. And the question that I have is, to what extent, when you curate, are you curating a portfolio of audiences? How do you think about, you know, the mix of audiences that you try and put together when you curate?
That's a great question. I think for us, and you know, again, we come from a social justice space that believes culture cures, right? So we believe that culture is how we're going to get through this and how we're going to find each other's humanity. So, you know, coming from an organizer space, the audience has always been front and center for me, and you know, and I will do whatever the audience wants, right? I mean, I'm really at the service of my audience or my community as an organizer. So for us, we think first and foremost about what is our audience. To your point about home, actually, you're now. Mm-hmm. I love when these aha moments come, right? Mm-hmm. We want to provide that piece of it for you. So we're constantly thinking about our audience, and we're also thinking about, in certain ways, some of the most nuanced of our audience, because the worst thing that we could do is the lowest common denominator, right? So, you know, if we were to say, well, we need to get black people, and it's like, great, then we need basketball and fried chicken, right? Like, mm-hmm. No, mm-hmm. Right? Like, that's going to get some, you know, probably some white girls who want to have sex with black men, but not much more, right? Which is fine, too. I mean, that's my mama. That's fine. It's fine. But there's an authenticity in there. Hi, mom. But there's an authenticity that we want to show our community we know, right? So it's not just going to be like, oh, this is Juneteenth at the MFA, so there's going to be, you know, breakdancing, or there's going to be Langston Hughes, right? We have the Roxbury Youth Orchestra, right? And we have a diverse group of black, brown, Asian youth playing spirituals on the violin, right? And so for us, it's in finding those unique nuances that give nods to whatever community we're working with, to be like, this isn't just some, you know, some lowest common denominator black thing, right? Like this is actually going to be a place where you're going to feel safe. And so I do think for us, the curation of the audience is much more important than that's going to lead anything that we bring in. You know, and that's thinking about who we're going to be bringing in. But again, we're an organizing organization, right? So I think we have a different mission than some other events in curation.
Which is exactly what's refreshing, right? I mean, if we're talking about getting culture out there, having another group with the same agenda that has provided us with the status quo, it's like, how important is that compared to this fresh agenda, this fresh approach to it? Does anyone want to speak to that, or this more about this, in response to this question, or about this excellence?
I was going to just make a comment just a little bit about what you're saying, Lenny, too, is that when we're thinking about audience at ArtsEmerson, I mean,
one thing, and this is really challenging because we're not thinking of one particular community, right? So we're thinking, we talk about theater being for everyone, but what does that mean? And I think there's a funny thing about, I don't know, what we would call like the theater audience, and it's an audience that is often, I like to call it an informed audience, an audience that goes to the theater, theater people go to the theater, right? And so it's an informed audience, and they are coming with a set of expectations in what they're informed about because they have a certain expertise themselves often in their work. And so what I would say is I'm actually trying to curate, I'm very particularly trying to curate, and I think we would all do this here at ArtsEmerson, we're trying to curate an ecstatic audience, right? An audience that is coming to the work, yes, bringing what they know, but then also really open to what they don't know. And that's a real challenge because people actually like to go, even in your experiences toward home, people like to go toward what they know. But if you're saying, you know, that we're going to try to create an institution that's focused on civic transformation through the shared experience of art and public dialogue, civic transformation isn't going to happen because we all hang out with people we know and the things we already know. That's actually going to happen because we come ecstatic to the things that are unknown to us. I don't know if anybody, if people saw the Samuel Beckett piece. Lisa Dwan was here a couple weeks ago doing Samuel Beckett, and we were able to create for her a complete blackout, which, by the way, is no simple feat. And the performance itself was stunning. But the part of the performance that kind of undid me and really made me, I mean, it was I call it an, like this, I love the word undoing, to be undone by the theater. The part that undid me was sitting in silence with this eerie music in the complete blackout of the play for like 3 minutes during the transitions between the three pieces, and just to be sitting with a community of people in that complete unknown, to me, that is like an ecstatic experience. It's never happened to me in the theater, and like I want like that experience. So, and I want to create an audience that wants what that represented in a way,
I feel like it's like that shared experience that you get. Like I think in terms of coming to a place, to an event, it's like this opportunity to be with other people and to experience something together. It's part of that journey. And I think speaking towards, you know, who exactly are we curating for? And I think I do, David, still have a hard time using that word curate. I think it's actually probably a word that's only come into like my vocabulary of describing what I do, probably in the past maybe year, maybe 2 years, I've always really thought of myself as a convener. I think that process of, you know, trying to really speak to the artist and finding out, yeah, who is it? Like, why, like, the artist themselves, like, I feel like I'm just sort of like this person who kind of like introduces people, like audiences to the filmmaker. And that idea of really trying to find out, okay, what is this filmmaker really trying to say or bring to people? Who are they trying to reach? Is it beyond, you know, just the Asian American community? Is it a film audience? Like, are those the people that we have, you know, sort of our ear for, you know, like are the people kind of listening to us? And when we can kind of like make that match, it seems to do very well. And I think that's like the idea of sort of a public service is really kind of what I feel like the festival is aiming for.
There's something that's come up a couple of times in this, the change between that you're able now to talk about curator as a role you're playing. The root of that word is actually really specific, and you use the word cure. And it's actually to care for is sort of the Latin root of that word, which is care for. And I think it's about what are we trying to cure? What are we trying to care for? It's actually the question underneath that. And why you would feel, I don't know, I'm putting words in your mouth, but it seems to me that part of the challenge of claiming a role of curator is the arrogance, the gatekeeping. And when you get to that place of, well, what am I caring for? You know, you talk about the specific audiences, David, and yet there are two people sitting here, Joan and David, Joan Langford and David Meister, who see almost everything we do. And so clearly, it's not about, you're not welcome at certain things, you're only welcome at these things. For us, we are trying to find that, we're trying to make a space that actually helps to cure that sense of we only belong here, we only belong there. And if this is fronting that, then it's only for them. So that's part of
due to David and credit sort of ArtsEmerson for this vision that they've had in terms of, you know, this, the space of the Paramount Center here, you know, sort of providing access. And I think he's really done something different for the city of Boston, for the arts community. It's something I don't think I'd ever quite expected. I think the first time I met David, I'm glad you spoke about sort of this intentionality of purposefully, you know, wanting to bring in creating spaces for other people as part of this, you know, work that you set out to do, because I think it's something that is very unique in the city of Boston. So I just wanted to...
And the listening. Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, when I was thinking about this panel and I was thinking about how do I listen and how do people listen, right? Because they're listening to the words, which is important, but when you're doing this work, the words that might be said in a space is one tenth of what you need to hear. And you need to especially hear what's not being said and whose voices don't have power. And you know, and it's like you need to hear those whispers as yells and hear these yells as whispers, right? Because they always yell and these, right? And it's finding that balance. And one of my experiences with ArtsEmerson, and I think actually with the two of you, I mean, I think when I first found out that you even existed in this world, praise God, it was both of you and Abe. You put on some earrings that I was like, this man's mine. I was like, I love him.
They didn't
we
pay
have
enough
to
today
out.
For me to wear the
right,
earrings.
Right, to wear the earrings, you know. But what
I heard that.
right, message. But what was so amazing was here, you know, theater has always been this thing, right, of privilege, right, and do you have money, or like you and your friends wearing your mom's clothes and like putting on a little play, but, you know, the idea of the accessibility of theater, right, like it just was, and here were two of you, very accomplished, making theater very accessible, and so we decided to delve in, and, you know, the first time we did it, we were promoting with our community, and we couldn't give away the theater tickets that we had. I mean, we literally had giveaways, and not enough people applied for the contest, so like, make it a contest. And one of them was like the editor of Boston Magazine, so I was like, do they even get the free tickets? Like, they have my, you know, like, geez. Carly, but over this past year, I mean, I think it was one of the last plays that we put out, we had like 60 people emailing. I mean, we had to put a cap on it and be like, okay, wait, we don't have this many tickets. And again, I think it's because of this ongoing dialogue that certain theaters, ArtsEmerson being one of them, Company One being another, that has been really willing to have this dialogue. You know, Theater Offensive, we're bringing it to the streets. Like, guess what? You are theater, right? And if you're not, become theater and be fabulous, right? Like, and making that accessible. And it's been beautiful to see, you know, and because we've seen over these 3 years where when it first started, as I said, we couldn't give away the tickets. And now, when we put it out, we actually end up emailing some of our best volunteers or whatever, because we know if we put it out to, like, the public that we're going to get a whole bunch of responses. And so I think for us, you know, that's just shown impact of people do want to be invited. But people aren't going to go to a place that they're not invited. And one of the things that David said that I'll end my talk on, or that I'll end this piece of my talk on, is David said, you know, our industry is about elitism, right? Like, the more you give, you eventually have one name, right? It's like you want to get your name on the brick, and then eventually you have your name on the theater, right? Which is the counter to everything that we're talking about now. And I think that, you know, theaters like ArtsEmerson, Company One are saying, no, let's do this dance in a different way. And you know, your name can be above a theater, but you are in no way any more of the patron than anyone else who might want to go to a land of make-believe. And I'll just throw out that Ernest Shackleton Loves Me, I think, was one of the best you to talk about make-believe. Like, we still make fun of it, and, like, we'll still, like, do scenes from Ernest Shackleton.
New plan.
Exactly, new plan.
Derek, will you introduce yourself and bring up whatever you were going to bring up?
Sure. I'm Derek. So
say that again.
Hi, I'm Derek from Boston.
Right, exactly.
Susan and Malia have actually started to touch upon some of what I was going to say, because I raised my hand like 10 minutes ago. So it's kind of moved on. No, the conversation's kind of moved on a little bit. But what I was thinking was that I really am glad that Susan mentioned the word, not curate, what was the other word you said?
Convene.
Because my impression of what Susan and Malia do is not so much convening, curating, because the conversation for a little bit was talking about us as curators and them as the audience, but my experience with your events isn't so much an us and them, it's more of an us, it's more of a we are them. There's that sense of, there's this fluidity of curators and audience, and we kind of all move back and forth between that space. And when I think about Juneteenth, I think about it not so much as, you know, you have this black audience coming to a white institution just for this particular event, but you're also opening space for the black community to really express itself in different ways, or just to express itself in places that it doesn't normally do that. And what I love about the Asian American Film Festival is that it totally removes the whole black-white paradigm that most of this country operates on. And despite that, I still feel very much at home at the theaters, at the shows. I get something from all the films that I go to, and I really enjoy that sense of still being in community, even though people might not visibly, might not look at me and say, oh, visually, oh, this guy is part of the community. I still feel very much a part of it. So that sense of us, not so much an us and them, but we are them, and you know, we're all in this together.
Thank you, Derek. We're gonna be wrapping up soon, but I wanna just go in another place. Go ahead. I'll come back.
I'm curious, and whether it's different for each of you, where do you go to listen?
That's a great question. Let's try to use that for a second. Say what you know about that.
Well, I mean, I create spaces, I create groups, I create opportunities to listen. I have to, I do very intensely, but I also just listen. Like, I'm an eavesdropper, and it's really bad. I mean, I can quote you conversations that you didn't know you had in public. I do it on planes, I do it in restaurants, I do it, my wife and I do it on the train. We don't even talk to each other. And then we get home and we go, wow, did you hear that? And so really it's a lifestyle. It may sound kind of creepy, but it's truly the come from is eavesdropping. And then synthesizing.
Great. Others?
For me, I am constantly reading, watching, reading, watching, listening. I mean, I always have headphones in, I always have a book in my hand, I always have I just am obsessed about every kind of possible story. So I think that's, for me, where I listen. I love story. And I don't even know how to process. I keep trying to read, like, books that are, like, organizational development, and it's like, oh, there's no story, I can't read that. And so it's just literally a consumer of stories obsessively. So that's how I listen.
I think probably a lot of the eavesdropping listening. I like listening to people talk. I think it's actually, I was sitting here thinking, it's kind of hard for me to be on this panel because I'm not usually the one who tends to, like, want to talk a lot. I tend to, like, listen to what other people have to say and their opinion and where they're coming from. So a lot comes from that, trying to attend events when I get the chance. But I have to admit, I'd say it's probably social media to a lot of what I sort of trying to follow other people and sort of, like, taking in what information that they're kind of putting out there. I also, in terms of the film festival, also go to other, what I consider experts in the field. I just got back from San Francisco where CamFest, it's the largest Asian American film festival in San Francisco, and get kind of try and absorb what I can out there and see what kind of fits and bringing it back to Boston.
Yeah, I think ditto for everything that was said, and we definitely convene. I mean, where we ask questions constantly, and we ask questions that we think we know answers to, and it sucks when I'm wrong. Then it's like, wait, what did they say? They want to do what? Oh, we didn't plan that, right? Like, why did we even ask? But That's the challenge. That's the challenge in listening, right? Is that you're like, oh, I said I would listen, you know? But the other place that I listen, which it goes to the eavesdropping, but the more ratchet, the better. If I'm getting my nails done and two women are talking about something, like, I will get into it. And there's something about, you were saying it, Polly, the storytelling. And there's something about regular people's stories that I love, that I think are more informative. You know, I would rather hear two sisters sitting at a nail salon talking about that no good whatever because it is good, and the way they drop certain things in. And if you're willing to explore or ask or engage in conversation, they'll take you there. And I think for me, I learned from a few mentors, you ask everybody for advice. Like, you know, you don't just ask the people who you think are smart enough to give you advice. But I've watched people who, you know, were quite big ask cab drivers what they thought about their pieces or their work or their, you know, or their anything. And I think for me, that's a place where I really try to do a lot of listening, is in those places where people just want to talk, you know, and people are just getting through. And in that, I'll hear certain things, or I'll be like, oh, we're all trap queens now, got it. Like, that's how we're moving forward. Because I'm of the age now where being a trap queen is like, none of my friends are going to tell me that, right? So I have to listen.
I'm going to interrupt you and go back to you, because where I was hoping we'd go before we end, we're supposed to wrap it up, but I'm going to see if we can have another 5 minutes or so. Thanks. You finally got to the juicy part here when you said about, like, sometimes you listen and you hear what you don't want to hear, and it's like, fuck that. I've already programmed this, you know. Excuse the language. But really, folks, I mean, what I can tell here is that this intention is genuine. What I also know from my own experience, anyway, is that for me, it's a constant struggle to stay genuine in this listening, and to not want to pull power, to not want to figure out where is my place in the status quo. So tell us, what's the messy part here? You dove in, and I want to thank you. Really, that's what, sorry, I'm not allowed to leave from my rest of soon. No,
it sucks. I can get started on the dirty part a little bit, but then everyone jumped in to back me up, so yeah, I don't seem like the only apple.
No, really. You were the brave one.
So I'll say that every time that we haven't listened, no one's come. And so I think for us, like, even though I'm like hella smart, and sometimes I'll find myself quoting Henry Ford, which is, if I asked my consumer what they wanted, they would have said a faster car or a faster horse, yeah, right? Faster horse, and I'll find myself quoting that and being like, obviously our consumer does not know. They would have asked for a faster horse, you know? And it was like, oh, you're a community organizer. That didn't work. You have to get them to wanting the car. It's your job, you know? And I think the older I get, the easier it gets. And, you know, and this goes to where I think, you know, there is an arrogance in being an organizer. There is an arrogance in saying you're going to be a leader. There is an arrogance in me saying it's worth your hour and a half to hear the shit I have to say, right? So in that, every day then, I have to check my ego. Every day when I'm doing my meditation and when I'm walking my path, I have to make sure that my intention stays pure, because I'm going to get it wrong anyway, right? Like, I'm going to get it wrong naturally just because I'm a human being and therefore I'm egocentric and I'm all of those things. And I think that when the older you get, you sort of lose that chip a little bit. I'm going to be 39. I'm getting old. No, look, grays. Not on the TV, but so y'all can see. But the older I get, the easier it gets, you know, because I get to this point where I'm like, oh, they don't like it, and I don't take it personal anymore. Where I think, like, 10 years ago, I did take it more personal because mm-hmm. it was a great idea because I had it. And now I'm just getting to the point where I'm like, listen, no one's liking it, and if they're not going to like it, then they're not going to come. let me just go home and, you know, complain to it, you know, to my girlfriend about how no one understands the power of authentic diversity in art or whatever. And then, you know, and then go on. But it's taken a while, and it still sometimes will hurt my feelings.
So, yeah, so others, where's the messy part here? And I'm not looking for a story with a happy ending.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, like no one coming.
Yeah, we've heard, we know, we get it about the happy ending.
So part of this whole thing, when you talk about it this way, is that it leads to a sense of lack of agency on the part of the curator. It leads to a sense of, well, they said that, so that's what I did. And that's actually also an abdication of responsibility. But what happens is once that's happening, and it comes in a lot of ways. Like people they're always sending me, like, do this play. Or when we first said that we were making the spaces available, people were saying, well, do my son's play. And that's really hard when you said, we want these spaces to be accessible, and all that's offered is, you do my granddaughter's show. You know, well, I can't actually do that. And why becomes a conversation. I would say that that's the messy part, it's the juicy part, it's the hardest part. It's not necessarily a happy ending, but it's also not necessarily a bad ending. We do wind up in real conversations when that happens. We wind up in real distinctions about, making real distinctions about what is an institution versus what is my family obligation. We wind up in conversations about what is the arts role in society, and what is society got to do for itself, and how can we enter that? And so we wind up in these conversations that I learn from all the time. Often I disappoint people, massively disappoint people, because the invitation, first of all, they don't trust it. That's the hardest part. When you first say that's what you're going to do, you're going to curate by listening, whether it's curating the resources or curating shows, people don't trust that. So then there's this testing, and the minute that I clench up, or any of us clench up around that, I thought so. You didn't really mean it. If you really meant it, my granddaughter would have her play. Yes. And so then you have to go past that. You may not ever get past that. There are people who have walked away. But if that's the hard part.
I think it's definitely in the sense of, you know, the conversations you have with people who have come to an event or something or had an experience where they felt disappointed. I'm thinking particularly for this one person. I ended up sitting next to them at this like lunch event, and they came and said, oh yeah, I came to the Schwartz program. And I was actually really, she pretty much said, like, I'm really disappointed about it. I felt like it was supposed to be about this, and it wasn't about that to me at all. And it kind of focused on sort of, you know, didn't address class issues. You know, And we're always so focused about trying to be inclusive and representative of our community and everyone's voice. And I felt like I felt a little bit like I had to kind of defend myself a little bit on that. But then also being like, okay, having to process that afterwards and going back to, you know, other community staff members and having this conversation with them and being like, oh, I felt like really bad about this. I felt like, you know, I kind of let this person down, you know. And, you know, I think it was sort of like the community of people that you're working with trying to be like, no, but you had a conversation with them. Mm-hmm. It still served a purpose. There were still a lot of other people that were there. We're not going to be able to hit it on the nail on every single person. It's like we're still having an impact, and I think it was sort of like trying to like not dwell on the fact this one person may not have hit a home run for them, but that there's still a bigger picture that we're still trying to work towards. So it's still kind of tough, mm-hmm. though. You know,
it's like a touching story. Though.
Yeah.
It's really, you know.
I would just say, I mean, it's like I feel like it's always hard, and you know, there's a lot of expectation when you're listening, like who are you listening to, and you're just inevitably not going to be able to hear everybody, and so you're going to be disappointing, you know. And I know, most recently, I spent some time working on a musical about transgender lives, mm-hmm. and it was really an important piece, and I was really proud to have been a part of it, and I sat in a town hall and listened to a lot of people talk about why not having all of the actors be transgender made that not authentic for them, and talk about, you know, not feeling heard, not feeling seen, and the whole purpose of working on the show was for a community to feel seen and heard, and then to feel like you had failed at that, even though you had been doing
doing all of the things you knew how to do in the circumstances, I think was, for me, a sense of that is, you know, the choices to do, I mean, think you have to put yourself out there, take those risks, take the feedback that comes, succeed where you succeed and fail where you fail, and then keep going, you know, and so, but you're always, you have to be hearing, you have to be willing, I think you have to be willing to sit, if you're going to take on any kind of leadership as a curator, you have to be willing to own how people react to it, and that is just not always going to be what, it's not always going to be how you hope or what you experience or what you meant, or, so that's kind of the, that's just inevitable.
But mm-hmm. Part of listening there is also to understand what went awry in the communication, like, yeah. You know, it's awful, mm-hmm. and yet something is being communicated, and right. What is it, and how do we learn, how do we yeah. go, but often it's often awful. I mean, yeah. You can look at the ArtsEmerson blog, and you can see how often it's awful. and we put that stuff out, we let it go there because it's part of the conversation. It doesn't feel good. It doesn't feel good.
Well,
to be
if I had known, I would have read the blog earlier.
but also, I just want to add one other thing because I think it's important. I think we all do this, everyone, including you, Aid, is that sometimes when you provide space for unheard people, they can then become heard, and sometimes these communities aren't used to being heard. And I think it's also important to be able to discern, right? So, you know, I joke around a lot, you know, and I'll say, like, nothing like, you know, getting a room full of colors together, right? Like, you'll hear nothing but problems. You know, in Boston, meanwhile, everyone has a college degree and is living in Milton. And so, you know, and you're, like, complaining like you're living in Tennessee. And I think that that's also important, that sometimes when you provide a space, and you do the best you can, people are gonna critique, and that's also a freedom because there's now finally a place where I can talk about this transgender space not being transgendered enough, or whatever it might be, right? Yeah. This black space not being black enough. Yeah. And so even though black people might be complaining or trans, you know, it's that we're finally here now, and we can finally say, well, you know, that's actually not how I would have done it. Like, no, and even though it's hurtful and whatever, it's like, wow, like we're actually finally in a place where we can have that critique of how we want to be presented, how we want to be curated. And I think if for many of us and for many of our communities, that's a revolutionary space and an important space as well. Yeah.
Thank you, Malia, because in my God, I was suspecting and hearing you all this talk about intention and all these things are totally true and really important. But I think in these stories of the messy part, the hard part, we're actually getting to the true value of this. This is actually the part where, regardless of arrogance or whatever, we're called on as curators, and many of you here as well have this work you do, to be more human. And I really admire the job that these four, I'm going to call you artists. I'd say it's your art form, this curation, and that's another debate for another day. But how much I admire the work that you do, and thank you for sharing. And then also, all you folks here, thank you for taking part in this and contributing as you did.
Thank you.